short verse of the Quran and the translation. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم
should be, every member of the Muslim community in particular should be involved in this mosque. I think unfortunately we have a tendency in the way that we have created our mosques to treat them as our personal assets. And this is the wrong attitude. We've ethnicized some of our masjids. The Quran tells us, the Holy Quran tells us that the mosques belong to Allah. They don't belong to anybody. They are in the ownership of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty. Yes, we have to have trustees, we have to have committees to manage and run them, but they are not anybody's personal belongings. So this mosque is the property of all of you, and there's a special reason that we need to refurbish this mosque. It's said that when the inhabitants surrounding the masjid wither away and the masjid becomes desolate, that doesn't mean that that property is no longer a mosque. It still remains a masjid, according to Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Abu Yusuf, until the last day, until the Day of Judgment. And interestingly, even though this property was desolate and in other people's ownership, the staff at the registry office still referred to it as a little mosque. And I think that tends to tell you that somebody upstairs is looking after this mosque and trying to pass it back to the Muslim community to refurbish. So please become part of this project and help us to ensure that this unique heritage is preserved. Now, my next speaker is somebody who's done some amazing work, really. We always knew about the heritage of the mosque, and the Abdullah Quilliam Society has done a great deal to keep that memory alive. But there's another reason that we need to treat this with importance. It wasn't just the mosque. It was the office of the first and only Shaykh of Islam, leader of the Muslim communities that we've had in Britain. And Professor Ron Gieves has actually written a book in 2010 which gives great insight into this great Muslim's life and what he achieved. And we thought that it was only fitting that in the 80th anniversary after he's passed away, that we should remember and bring this man's achievements to life. And the best way of doing that was through an annual memorial lecture, because he himself loved lectures and speeches. And we thought it would be a fitting tribute to invite Professor Ron Gieves to talk about the contribution of Abdullah Quilliam to the development of Islam and Muslim institutions in Britain. Professor Ron Gieves is a professor in comparative study of religion at Liverpool Hope University. He's also the director for the Centre for the Study of Muslims and Islam in Britain. He's a pioneer in the study of Muslims in Britain and has around 70 publications on the study of religion, most of which deal with Muslim presence in the West. He's travelled extensively around the Muslim world. He is the author of Abdullah Quilliam's biography, and he's also helped produce two radio documentaries on Quilliam's life, and he's now working on a BBC documentary. So, welcome to Professor Gieves, and thank you for being the first person to deliver an annual lecture in memory of the late Shaykh Abdullah Quilliam.
Is that okay? Can everybody hear me? Okay. All right. As-salamu alaykum. Well, can I first thank the Abdullah Quilliam Society for this honour of being able to deliver the first annual lecture. And I guess I would like in some ways to say that this journey of writing Abdullah Quilliam's biography has been for me one of the most extraordinary adventures of what hasn't been, I must admit, an adventurous life. I first started to study the presence of Muslims in this country in 1988 at Leeds University, where I did a research paper for a master's degree looking at the origins of the Muslim presence in Leeds. And what I came across, and you'll know better than me, were some extraordinary stories of some people who were still alive at that time, who had come to this country perhaps between the wars or during the Second World War, having been instrumental in creating the Muslim community as we know it today. Roger Ballard, a colleague of mine, had called those people in his own work pioneers. A kind of unusual term, perhaps, to describe people coming to a nation that was already well populated, but in terms of those people's lives and their stories, as young men arriving in this country and creating what were the beginnings of a Muslim community, for me, touched my heart and went on to become a part of my career. Later, I was to find out that those men were not actually the beginning, that the beginnings of Islam and Muslims in this country go back much longer than that. Probably, in fact, even longer than Abdullah Quilliam. Even in this city, in 1830, there were graves of Muslim sailors, 19, that were in the Fazakerley Cemetery. Liverpool has an honoured and cherished history. with regard to the Muslim presence in this country, and one which every Muslim of this city should be proud about, of, and every Muslim of this country should know about. And once we begin to explore the history of Islam and Muslims in this city, it doesn't take long before we hit the giant presence of Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam. Quilliam was a Christian. Not a Christian because he was born one, but a Christian because from childhood he was a religious man. His own family were Methodists, and his wife's family were Methodists. On both sides of his family, including his grandfather's, they were preachers. He was well known in the city many, many, many years before he became a Muslim, in the media of the city, in which he was known as the Temperance Child. For those that don't know what the Temperance Movement was, it was a movement that existed in 19th century Christianity to abolish or oppose the abuse of alcohol. His grandfather was very strong in that movement and used to preach across the northwest of England. And used to take the young William Quilliam with him and sit him on the stage. And at the age of 9, he stood up and gave his first lecture, in which he denounced the impact of alcohol on British society. And he made a pledge at the age of 9 that he would never allow it to touch his lips. In old age, he used to look back on his life and say that one of the most sensible decisions he ever made, and one which he was proud to have kept, was the decision never to drink alcohol. So we see him, even as a little boy, as a figure known in the city, and one who is not afraid to stand up in public and say what it is that he believes. We see Quilliam throughout his life, when we begin to research it, on a journey that was to take him to Islam. That journey was to take him away from his own Methodist roots, with a little bit of time spent with the city's Unitarians, so we begin to see a picture of someone perhaps who's beginning to challenge a Trinitarian view of God and move towards a more Islamic understanding of Tawhid. Somewhere in the late 1880s, possibly, although we don't know for sure, because he needed to rest, he had worked very hard in order to get his law qualifications, practicing as a journalist in this city in the daytime and studying his law in the evening, it would appear that under medical advice, he travelled to Spain, crossed over into Morocco. And it's in Morocco that he discovers something which he had indicated that he wanted to see. A society which was able to operate and function without the abuse of alcohol. Whatever happened in Morocco, when he came back, he spent some time reflecting on that experience. He didn't make an initial and quick decision, probably about 1 year to 2 years, reflecting, and we find him writing his first article on Islam, but not as a Muslim. At the end of the 1880s, he was to publicly announce in the media of the city that he had converted to Islam. He began his work not, as we've seen in Brown Terrace, but he actually began his work to promote Islam in this city, not so far away from here, before even there was a Roman Catholic cathedral there, or an Anglican cathedral there, on Mount Vernon. And he rented a property, and he began to advertise that he was going to give lectures there, in which he would promote the teachings of Islam. People started to come, initially in very small numbers, and they had great difficulties as well, because there were certainly some people in the city who were not too happy with the idea of Islam being promoted and attacked that first community. Stones were thrown, windows were broken, and a landlady who owned the property got quite angry. She was a devout Christian, and she said she was not going to accept people in her property that were opposed to the idea of crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And she threw them out. Thus were the humble beginnings of Islam being promoted in this country and in the city of Liverpool. But Quilliam was not the kind of person who gave up easily, as many people would find out throughout his life. Set him a challenge, and he would normally rise to it. He started to seek for another premises and found, as we've already seen, Brown Terrace. They rented the property using his own wealth. By that time, he had his own law company downtown in the city, one of the most successful law companies in the northwest of England. William Quilliam, now Abdullah Quilliam, was well known in this city in a number of areas. This was a man who believed strongly in justice. And that combination of a man who believed in social justice, way ahead of his time, and the teachings of Islam, were to come together in a particular model which I still feel that Muslims today can learn from. Quilliam did not hide or disappear from the issues of his day because he had become a Muslim. The opposite. The fact that he had become a Muslim made him even more determined that the issues of his day should be confronted and dealt with. Again and again and again, we hear him say, Islam is a religion of reason, and Islam is a religion of justice. It is not a religion of tribes. It's a universal way to commit one's life to Almighty God. So where do we find him operating? We find him operating down on the docks, where he becomes president of one of the earliest trade unions, looking after the dock workers, whose labor, right the way, of course, until when the docks closed, was always difficult. Short term. Job here, laid off there, and it was in his day too. We find him operating through his law firm, looking after the interests not just of the Muslims who were beginning to appear in the city through the docks, but also looking after the interests of women, perhaps women who others would have perceived as immoral, whose husbands had deserted them or neglected them, sometimes with children. And we find him beginning to take on their cases free of charge in order to seek out their husbands and seek out the money which they were owed for the children that had been born through those men. We find him also operating as the lawyer of the first society looking towards, if you want, a more moderate legal system in the society, and opposed to some of the Victorian habits of punishment, particularly capital punishment. Wherever there was an issue of justice or injustice in this city, we find Abdullah Quilliam. But we also find him, of course, primarily and significantly as the Sheikh of Islam of the United Kingdom. I suspect that Quilliam had first come to the attention of Muslim rulers, particularly the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire, because he had taken on a particular issue that we know is sensitive to Muslims. You in your own lives will have hit that sensitivity with the Salman Rushdie affair. how the Prophet is represented. At that time, there was an author by the name of Paul Kane. He was the largest seller of fiction in Britain, the first man to sell 1 million works. Right up there with Charles Dickens at that time. Also a playwright, who Quilliam knew very well. Paul Kane decided to put on a play representing the life of the Prophet Muhammad in the Strand Theatre, Lyceum Theatre, Strand, London, with the most famous Victorian actor of the time playing the part of the Prophet Muhammad. This had come to Quilliam's attention, and he immediately started to oppose the performance of the play. He was more successful, perhaps, than those who tried to get Salman Rushdie's novel stopped, and he actually managed to succeed. He succeeded by contacting Muslims around the world, particularly those in India, and asked them to protest against the performance of the play in London. As the protests came in, the British government got a little bit nervous. This is only 30 years after the War of Independence, or mutiny in 1857. Nobody wanted Muslims rebelling in the empire. It came to the Foreign Office. The Foreign Office got in touch with the Lord Chamberlain. The Lord Chamberlain got in touch with the Lyceum Theatre and said, take the play off. This brought Quilliam to the attention, of course, of not only the Sultan, but also the Emir of Afghanistan. And in 1893, we find a substantial donation being given to him of 2,300 guineas, a vast princely sum in Victorian days, from the Emir of Afghanistan in honor of his work on behalf of Islam, and the title of Sheikh al-Islam being bestowed upon him by the Caliph, the Sultan, and accepted and acknowledged by Queen Victoria. So no doubt about it, officially the leader of British Muslims. 2,300 guineas to spend. No conditions. The son of the Emir of Afghanistan brought the gift across to Liverpool and said that my father says you can spend it on what you like. It's yours if you want it. Quilliam responded by saying, Allah has blessed me with enough. The 2,300 guineas will be spent for the promotion of Islam in Britain, and he purchased this building. It wasn't only a mosque. Inside, there were two Muslim schools, one for girls, one for boys. And at the height of those schools, they were bringing children across from the Muslim world who were being educated there and who were then going on as graduates from the school into what was at that time the University College of Liverpool, now the University of Liverpool. He also held in the evenings night classes, not for Muslims, but for anybody who wanted to come. And in those night classes, you would have been able to have studied the latest technologies of the day. Electricity, gas, photography. I would say almost the equivalent of going to do IT today. These were brand new technologies that you could have gone and studied in the evenings there. There was a lecture hall in which Quilliam would lecture virtually every Sunday afternoon. Not on Islam necessarily, but on many, many, many topics. He was a man of an extraordinary range of intellectual achievement. 2,000 books in his library, many of them on Christian theology, but also geology. He was a member of the Royal Society of Geology and a significant amateur geologist. Imagine a lecturer as a Victorian, and you hear that a member of the Royal Society of Geology has given a lecture on stones and the dating of stones on a Sunday afternoon in Brown Terrace, Liverpool. And off you go to hear about this, only a few years after Darwin. A little bit controversial. And a man gets up and says, I have dated these stones personally, and they are 5 million years old, or 50 million years old, and talks about the development of those stones, how they fit, quite in some senses, specialized lectures. And then at the end he says, Christians in the audience might have problems to know that there are stones that are 50 million years old, and that as a scientist I have tracked them. He said, but as a Muslim, I have no problems with this. It affirms my faith that my Lord, Almighty Allah, was creating stones even 50 million years ago. He didn't mess around. He challenged. He provoked. The same with the first convert to Islam. The first convert to Islam that Abdullah Quilliam was successfully able to bring to the religion took place in an extraordinary meeting across the water on the other side of the Mersey River in the town of Birkenhead. Quilliam went across there invited to give a temperance lecture, as he had done since he was 9 years old. He didn't mention Islam. He gave his standard lecture about the sins and the problems of alcohol abuse in the city. And at the end of the lecture, he said, there is one religion in the world that does not permit the drinking of alcohol, for it is forbidden by Almighty God in his final revelation in the Quran. And he left the room. One man came rushing after him and said, how can I find out more about this religion that doesn't permit the drinking of alcohol? William replied, walk with me and I'll tell you about it. And they walked home together in the evening. As they walked side by side, the man turned around and said, I would like to be a Muslim. How is it possible? He said, it's very simple. There is a statement, shahada, a witnessing. And he explained what that was. He said, it needs two witnesses. He said, but I guess, since there's only me to witness it, it'll just have to be done with one witness, and Almighty God will be our second. And right there in the street, walking home that night, that man became a Muslim. And then Abdullah Quilliam turned around and said, in future, we can keep to the law, because now there are two of us, and all future converts will be able to have two witnesses. He went on to convert in this city 250 families between 1893 and 1908. But not just in this city. They came from all over. Scotland, Wales, London. 500 plus converted to Islam through his efforts, including those, some of those that were to become significant figures in the working London community. He represented all walks of life, and this is something else I think we need to learn. I heard the expression ethnic mosques. It's not for me to preach to Muslims about their mosques. I have no right or privilege to do that. But Quilliam's mosque was certainly not ethnic in any shape or form. Quilliam believed in equality, and he believed above all that the religion of Islam was the religion of equality. It represented all human beings. Rich, poor. And if you had gone along to the mosque, somewhere around 1902, when it was at its absolute peak, you would have had a very extraordinary experience. You would have found yourself at Juma prayer, lining up shoulder to shoulder with all walks of life, not just from the city of Liverpool, but from across the globe. Quilliam writes down who attends his Juma prayer. 57 nationalities coming in through the docks, some significant visitors. Some of those visitors were very wealthy men indeed. Some of the wealthiest men in the Muslim world were coming into the city at that time. Nawabs from India, generals from the Ottoman Empire. But also, at the other extreme, there were some of the poorest and most oppressed of Victorian life. Some of you may even have ancestors who belong to those people. The Lascars, the sailors, who were fueling the British merchant fleet at that time and made the merchant fleet what it was, the greatest merchant fleet in the world. But of course, it was primarily the sailors, particularly those below decks. Many of those were Muslims from India, Muslims from Yemen, Muslims from Somalia. And they were arriving in the city, very often penniless and homeless, looking for the ship's home. They knew there was a mosque in Liverpool, and they found their way there, believe you me. And who looked after their interests? Abdullah Quilliam. This man was a lawyer, as well as an imam. You better not mess with him. As an imam, he sadly held their funerals. And he was performing Muslim funerals in the northwest of England for 25 years. He also married them. Very controversial. The only girls they were married in those days were English girls. And that was certainly frowned upon by Victorian society. More than 50 weddings took place at this mosque. And believe you me, the media were outside at every one of them. He would go to the hospital when they were dying or sick. He would find out who their families were and which village in India they lived in. And he would promise them two things. I will make sure that the wages you are owed by the companies go to your families, and I promise you a Muslim funeral with the right and proper rites here in this city of Liverpool. And they were able to die with peace. And believe you me, he went straight off to the shipping agents and said, this man is owed this much money, this is the address in India, this is the village, this is his wife. This money goes there. If it doesn't, I'll see you in court. You've normally got paid. What do we have? We have a Sheikh al-Islam who is an imam. A real imam in the truest sense of the word. To a community of sailors, Nawabs, 57 nationalities from around the world, and 250 converts. Who were those converts? Some of them were some of the most significant people in Liverpudlian and British society at the time. The Mayor of Stalybridge, Lord Stanley, a very large landowner just outside Greater Manchester, where the Manchester United footballers live these days, on what was his land. The kind of Muslim that Quilliam was a very interesting one. When Lord Stanley died, huge landowner who had Christian churches on the villages which he owned, some Christian priests denounced that he was a Muslim. He said, it's not possible. This is a peer of the realm, a great British landowner. He has churches on his land. How could he be a Muslim? Quilliam came forward and he said, I know that he was a Muslim. He took his Shahada in front of him. He said, and here are the documents in which he has requested a Muslim funeral on his own land. He said, it is perfectly within the bounds of Islamic law for a Muslim who is a landowner of Christian villages to provide places of worship of the one God to Christian people when there are no Muslims to provide mosques for. He said that is the right and the proper way for a Muslim to behave in a Christian land. we begin to see a different understanding, I think, from this man of what Islam is and its universality and its generosity. I could talk about Abdullah Quilliam for a long, long time. I don't want to take up. There's a lot to go on here after me. But he's a giant amongst Muslims, and he's a giant amongst human beings. And I remain, and continue to remain, very proud that somewhere it was decided that I was able to become his biographer. I learned much from charting his life, of the history of this city. I learned much about Liverpool as the first, one of the first, possibly even the first multicultural city in Britain. Quilliam mixed every day as a close personal friend with the chief rabbi at the synagogue, with the Greek Orthodox community that was also had built its church at the same time, debated intensely and sometimes controversially with the Christian bishops of the city, defended Islam stoutly, boldly, fiercely sometimes, and was quite prepared as a citizen of Britain, a loyal one and a passionately patriotic one, to challenge British governments when he felt that British governments had committed injustices. He had a very simple and sometimes complex way of approaching who he was as a human being. My first loyalty, he said, is to Almighty God. My second is to my Empress, Queen Victoria. He said, but I also have a loyalty to my religion given to me by Almighty God, in which I have found the truth. That religion has a caliph, and that caliph is the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire. He said, and just as Roman Catholics in Britain are also citizens of this country, but have a religious allegiance to the Pope, so I have a religious allegiance to the Caliph of Sunni Islam. He said, if a government of this country commits an injustice against anyone, whether Muslims around the world, or the poor of this country, or the women of this country, I have the right as a citizen of the democracy to denounce them and protest against them. And equally, he said, if they prevent me from my religion, I will also protest against them. So being a citizen doesn't mean to say that you're always obedient when injustices are committed. But you have to stand up, he says, in a democracy against injustice. That's how democracy improves. So we find a man who is an active citizen. In that mosque, besides two schools and evening classes and a lecture hall, there was also another extraordinary facility. There was an orphanage. That orphanage was for some of the poorest children in the streets of Liverpool that William would accept, when even Christian orphanages would not. He used to take those children that he had inside that orphanage on holiday to the Isle of Man, to his family home, with his own children. Those children were not Muslims. I'll tell you the story that how that arose. He came to the annual general meeting of the Liverpool Muslim Institute that he founded, troubled. And he said, I was met by a Jewish woman in the streets of Topstep who had a child that was born out of wedlock, which she could not keep. And she came up to me and said, I have heard that you are a devout Muslim. He said, I try to be. He said, I have also heard it's true that it is beholden to a Muslim to protect and bring up orphans. He said, that is a part of my religion from the time of my Prophet. He said, will you take my child? William came back and he announced to his annual general meeting that I have thought long and hard. He said, and I have realized that even if I take one child, there are so many more. What can we do as Muslims in this city to help those children that are in the same plight as that innocent child of that Jewish mother? He said, and I am putting to you, my committee, Muslims, fellow Muslims of Liverpool, that we should open an orphanage and help as many children as we can who are similar in condition. And they did. One of the members asked his sheikh, and what happened to the Jewish child that was offered to you? He said, I accepted that child and it will be brought up along with my own family. Touches your heart, doesn't it? And it makes us think, I think, inside ourselves, not just what it means to be a Muslim, but I think it also makes us think about what it means to be a human being. And issues of humanity and compassion, kindness, and consideration for all. My final story, I think, will be one of celebration. This city, in Quilliam's time, was one of the most powerful cities in the world. It's certainly one of the wealthiest. The wealth coming in through its docks from the British Empire was unbelievable at that time. And of course, so many of the extraordinary buildings that we see in our city centre of Liverpool came from that wealth. At the beginning of the 20th century, the Empress died, and Britain was getting ready for the coronation of a new emperor. Troops were coming in. Nawabs were coming in. Rajas were coming in. The whole world was coming in to Britain for the celebration of the coronation. And many of those figures were coming in through the city of Liverpool, through the docks, and then making their way down to London. A regiment of Indian troops came into the city of Liverpool, and the city council, not being slow to realize there was an opportunity, asked the regiment of Indian troops to parade in their extraordinarily wonderful uniforms in the city center and to attend a gala that night in the what would have been fairly newly built King George's building. All of the city gentry turned out, the Lord Mayor, and everybody was there. If you didn't have a ticket, you were nobody in this city. Abdullah Quilliam had a ticket. He was the guest of the Lord Mayor, and he entered the hall, dressed as the Sheikh al-Islam, side by side with the first Lord Mayor of Liverpool. Sitting down the bottom, guests of honour in the front rows of this magnificent building of empire with the troops that had come for the coronation. They knew him. By that time, his reputation had gone out across the Muslim world. The man, the Christian who had converted to Islam and was bringing Islam to the heart of the British Empire itself. And those troops rose. It stirs me still to think of this. You can imagine it. They came to their feet, the whole regiment, and they saluted him. Not with a British military salute, but with a Muslim, Allah Akbar! Allah Akbar! Allah Akbar! And you can just imagine it, can't you? All these Victorian gentry turning around to see who had entered the room and who had created that kind of a response. Shaykh al-Islam of the UK. And they wanted to give him tribute for the work that he had done to bring Islam into Britain. Many of the people that are sitting in front of me, you are his successors. You should be very proud of him. And I know that he was here today and he was able to see the thousands that come to the Al-Rahma Mosque for Jummah prayer, flooding outside into this building and sometimes into the streets. He would find it extraordinary, but a fitting tribute of the work which he did back in the 19th century. Thank you very much.
And then go on to his own talk, which will be about how Islam and the media was portrayed then and now, and Sheikh Quilliam's methods of Dawah.
Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum. I'm very glad to see everyone here. And I'd just like to begin by thanking Jahangir Muhammad and the trustees of the Abdullah Quilliam Society for bringing us together this afternoon. I think already we've realised that this is a very special occasion, in fact. And I'd also like to thank Professor Jeeves, Ron Jeeves especially, for all his work. And I've read the book, I've listened to him speak, and I'm aware that there's probably a lot more that he knows that he hasn't had yet a chance to talk about or to write another book. And in his introduction to his book, he says, "I haven't finished with Abdullah Quilliam, and I'll be back."
There's a second book on the way.
I'm very glad to hear it, because I can see that in doing this research, Professor Ranjit has been inspired by this man as not just a Muslim, but as a human being, and in the situation that he found himself in. And therefore, it's not just a matter of dry academic research, but it's actually exploring what was it about this man that made him so special. And I think that if, in the rightness of time, you also have a search engine in which you can look for more information and knowledge about Abdullah Quilliam, Sheikh al-Islam, then perhaps it should be called Ask Jeeves. But with the right spelling. I think I'd like to begin, before I read the speech that that Abdullah Quilliam gave in 1928, so this is quite near the end of his life, it's only 6 years before he died. And then to continue to give my talk, I'd just like to begin by reciting some ayats of Quran which immediately sprang to my mind the more that I found out about his life. And these are from the end of Surah Al-Anfal. So I'll just begin with a recitation of those ayat and then reading the translation. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. والذين آمنوا وهاجروا وجاهدوا في سبيل الله والذين آوى ونصروا أولئك هم المؤمنون حقا لهم مغفرة ورزق كريم والذين آمنوا من بعد وهاجروا وجاهدوا معكم فأولئك منكم صدق الله مولانا العظيم. And the translation of these ayah, which I'm reading from the Beauty translation, I do recommend it as a very accurate, fresh, scholarly translation, which is in today's English, if you like. I mean, one finds that the translations of Muhammad Marmaduke Kaur and Yusuf Ali, and certainly Sayle's translation, almost belong to another age. And this is a fresh translation, but also a very accurate one. And the translation is, those who believe and have made hijra, that who have emigrated, and done jihad, who have struggled in the way of Allah, and those who have given refuge and help, they are the true believers. They will have forgiveness and generous provision. Those who believe and make hijra later on and accompany you in doing jihad, they also are of your number. And I think included amongst those who made hijra, if you like, and one can interpret that as making hijra from ignorance to knowledge, to wisdom, and doing jihad, this is struggling in the way of Allah, and it has many aspects. Some people think it's just jihad on the battlefield, but as the Prophet said, the greatest jihad is against yourself, against the ignorance in your own self. And jihad generally is calling people to the truth and establishing that truth. And this is what, as we've heard from Professor Ramji, this is what Abdullah Quilliam busied himself with. And so now I'll continue straight away by reading the speech that he gave in Cairo in 1928. This has recently been translated from the Arabic, so it's only quite recently come to light. And this is a translation of the summary of the lecture. Apparently it went on for 2 hours, to the extent that his wife became concerned about his health, because it was very enthusiastically received by the people who were present. And, you know, once he got going, he couldn't really stop. But this is just a summary of something, part of what he said, but it conveys the spirit of that talk. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dear brothers, I apologize for not being a competent Arabic language speaker, but my talk tonight is being given to an Arabic audience. This situation reminds me of a speech that I gave in Lagos when His Majesty Sultan Abdul Hamid II delegated me to attend a presentation of the Sultan Badge of Honor to Mohammed Bayashini in recognition for his overseeing the building of a mosque there, which cost £5,000, which in those days was a lot of money. The people attending the event came from 6 mixed backgrounds and nationalities, so we needed 6 interpreters to translate my speech to the audience. From among the audience, 16 people converted to Islam immediately after the end of the speech. And this was an aspect of Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam, that he would speak and people would become Muslim on the spot. Today, we do not have any Christians present in this gathering. I wish that there were some Christians with us today, so that they could hear about the merits of Islam and learn of its real value and benefits, so that they could become friends of Islam. Dear brothers, I am pleased to be with you tonight and to talk to you. I have chosen to speak to you about myself, about my role and the responsibility I decided to take on to present Islam after I became a Muslim. I apologize to you if my choice to talk about myself appears to be selfish and self-centered. 60 years ago, my doctor advised me to take a rest for the sake of my health and to spend some time in Gibraltar. After I had arrived in Gibraltar, I boarded a ship to Tangiers to see the lands of Morocco. And so this would actually be in 1887. While I was on the ferry, I saw some Moroccan hajis scooping up water from the sea and using it carefully and scrupulously to wash themselves. The ship set sail, and as soon as it left port, these hajis stood neatly together in a line and started to do the prayers in full submission and tranquility. They were not at all troubled by the force of the strong wind or by the swaying of the ship. I was deeply touched by the look on their faces and their expressions, which displayed complete trust and sincerity. I was intrigued and became very interested to acquire knowledge and learn about their religion and those who believe in it. In Tangier, I met a Muslim man who spoke English, and we remained companions, especially when he saw that I wanted to learn about the principles of Islam and the ties that bring Muslims together. One evening, as we sat together in a cafe in Tangier, we met a Jewish man whom my friend knew. My friend said, "I will give you an illustration which demonstrates the truth of the three main religions in the world, the religions which the three of us represent. The prophets are the messengers of Allah, sent to mankind to convey to people principles, rules, and practices, and to guide them on the path of happiness. This is why Adam, Noah, Ibrahim, and all the prophets who came after Ibrahim were sent. Before people split into Jews and Christians and Muslims, they were all one group. Then Jesus came with a fresh guidance and insights to benefit his followers. He and his followers then separated from Judaism. They were right to do so, because Christianity came after the previous revelation and presented a corrected and better path. Then after that came Muhammad, may Allah bless him and grant him peace, believing in all the previous prophets and guiding people to the straight path, the Sirat al-Mustaqim, a straight path for those who sought it, to benefit them with guidance and direction. The Muslims then separated from the other religions, and they were right to do so, in the same way as the Christians had done in the past. Just as Christianity is better than Judaism, because its divine inspiration, its wahi, came more recently, so too Islam is better than both Christianity and Judaism, because Islam's divine inspiration, its wahi, is more recent, and it is the last and everlasting religion." I listened to my friend talk and thought deeply about what he was saying. It was reasonable and logical, and personally, I felt it did not contradict my belief. After this, I became determined to read books about Islam and to see what prominent authors and scholars have written about Islam. I read a translation of the Noble Quran and the Book of Heroes written by Carlyle, as well as many other books. By the time I left Tangier, I had submitted to Islam and surrendered to Allah, and I testified that it is the true deen. And it's interesting that I noticed that Professor G said that he accepted Islam sometime after that, but I think probably what happened was that he accepted it then, but didn't make it public until later, until he was ready to do that, because it was new territory, and certainly in that age, he was the first English person to accept Islam in England. I think when you look at the history, you find, you go even back in the Elizabethan period, there are examples of Englishmen accepting Islam, but certainly in the Victorian age, he was the first. When I returned to England, I became preoccupied with thinking about what dawah methods would be appropriate to use when inviting people to accept Islam and to convince them of the truth of the deen. I was aware that the English people were already filled with a hostility towards Islam, which had been fed to them by European anti-Islam ideologists. This was a strong barrier in my way, which prevented me from openly exchanging my ideas and views with English people. If you talk to English people about Islam, they think you are talking to them about some heathen religion. Using the press was even more difficult. Newspapers never accept or allow our dawah to Islam activities that we cover. I then thought of a different approach to spread the dawah to Islam by joining the Association for the Prohibition of Alcohol, who used to give regular lectures. For example, in one of this association's gatherings, I gave a lecture about fanaticism and fanatics. I started the talk by mentioning the names of well-known specialists in the spheres of invention and social reform, like Stephenson, the inventor of steam power, and Wilberforce, the campaigner against slavery. I explained how each of these leading figures had resisted persecution and ridicule and had dedicated their talents towards their goal. I said that we can see that in spite of all that opposition, the effects of their achievements and reforms have gained global recognition have spread the benefits of humanity a great deal. I continued in my talk by mentioning the Prophet Muhammad, may Allah bless him and grant him peace, saying, "This master reformer came with a clear message, inviting people to what is good and beneficial. In spite of this, he had to face harm and persecution, just like any other great reformer who had been dedicated to the welfare of people. Later on, when people realized the value of his message and believed him, they entered Islam in large groups and continued to do so until their numbers reached hundreds of millions right across the world. And today it's thousands of millions." and then talked about some of the moral principles and teachings of Islam, which the Prophet, may Allah bless him and grant him peace, invited people to adopt. Some of the journalists who attended the lecture found this very amusing and asked me if they could publish a summary of my talk in their newspapers. I said no, and made it a condition that they could only publish my words if they printed the whole talk and not just the summary of it. I only gave my permission for the whole talk to be published. They accepted this and recorded the full lecture for the purpose of the publication. Soon after, however, some priests heard about the proposed publication of the lecture, and they told the newspaper editors not to publish this lecture, saying that it was a conspiracy to invite people to a heathen religion by encouraging Christians to leave their religion. So the newspaper editors broke their agreement with me and published a summary rather than the whole lecture, in which they removed all my references to the Prophet Muhammad. May Allah bless him and grant him peace. We haven't got any journalists here. Relying on my agreement with the newspaper editors that I had only given them permission to publish the whole lecture and not just the summary, I sent them a warning that I would take legal action against the press and take them to court for breaching the agreement and misrepresenting the contents of my lecture. I urged them to honour their agreement and to publish the full lecture. The success of my lecture and the publicity surrounding it generated a wider and greater interest than expected. As a result of the publicity which the lecture had engendered, I decided to establish a centre in my hometown of Liverpool, a place where we could pray and celebrate our religious feasts and also give lectures. Indeed, we chose and set up a centre, half of which is used for worship and the other half of which is used for teaching, guidance and delivering speeches. Soon after we had opened this Islamic centre, we faced hostility from some priests who started sending thugs and misguided people who demonstrated to us how they had been misinformed and brainwashed and led to believe that we were bad people. Their misconceptions were revealed when these thugs and misguided people visited us and found out for themselves that what they had been told about us was not true. These realisations of truth then had a positive impact on these people. Some of the persecution which we faced from these groups included their throwing rubbish and dirt on people while they were doing the prayer or as they were leaving the centre, throwing stones at the imam and putting sharp pieces of broken glass on the prayer mats and floor so that people were cut on their foreheads, hands and feet. One evening, while we were all in the mosque, they took the opportunity to string razor wire across the doorsill so that people would fall over it in the dark and suffer injury. It just so happened that on that day, I had a cane which had been given to me by a friend as a present. Luckily, as we walked out that evening, I was holding the cane, something I do not usually do. As we were leaving the mosque, I was walking ahead of the others with the cane held in front of me. Suddenly, I felt the cane hit something, and it became stuck. I soon discovered the razor wire, which had been placed across the doorstep to hurt us. But Allah saved us from any harm, and from the harmful people who put it there. One day, my Muslim brothers and I entered the mosque. I was due to give a talk about the interpretation of the Noble Quran. I saw that a group of people had already arrived before us. Their faces were unfamiliar and looked suspicious. I paid them no attention, and having recited some verses of the Noble Quran, I started explaining and interpreting the meaning of the verses and showing the wisdom and lessons within them. When I had finished, one of the members of the suspicious group took some stones out of his pockets and threw them on the floor. He turned to the rest of his group and said, "Now I can become a Muslim. Whoever of you wants to throw stones at Muslims can throw their stones at me now." They all then threw away whatever stones they had in their pockets, accepted Islam, and became Muslims. This man, who had been the leader of the group, later became my firmest supporter and my right-hand assistant. He chose Jamaluddin Ali as his new name. From then on, he accompanied me on every Dawat al-Islam trip that I took. Once we went to Birkenhead, as it had been agreed that I would give a talk to the Association of Prohibition of Alcohol, based in Birkenhead. In this talk, I spoke about Islam and the Prophet Muhammad, may Allah bless him and grant him peace. The lady who was the secretary of the association displayed an interest in my talk and said that although she had a bad opinion of Islam, she wanted me to provide her with some more information about Islam. Isn't it true, she asked, that the Muslim prophet said that women do not have souls and will not go to paradise? I told her that this was not true and that this was a lie which the enemies of Islam spread. I gave her accurate information about the Islamic religion and its principles and its foundations. This lady then accepted Islam and became a Muslim and named herself Fatima, and also helped her sister and brother-in-law to become Muslims. One day, I gave a talk in Liverpool. When I had finished, a man came up to me and asked to walk along with me on my way home because he wanted to talk to me. We walked along together and started talking about Islam. He asked questions and I provided him with answers in a gentle way. When we reached my house, I invited him in for tea. He stayed until midnight, and still we were talking about Islam and its honorable status and its valid scientific principles, which are applicable for all time and in all places. At the end of our talk, he said, "If everything that you have said about Islam is true, what is stopping you from becoming a Muslim?" I replied, "I'm proud to inform you that I am a Muslim." This man then accepted Islam and took Jamaluddin Bukhari as his new name. Many people think that Lord Headley is the first English lord to convert to Islam. This is not true, because Lord Stanley of Alderley became a Muslim before him, and he always preferred to be called Abdurrahman Effendi. He used to come to our mosque and pray with his brothers, in spite of the distinct difference in social class between them. The number of English people who converted to Islam increased to several hundred. While we were talking about the mosque and the people who do the prayer, I would like to say that we follow the practice of the Islamic Sunnah. The women pray in a separate row behind the men. As regards working mosque, for a time their way of doing the prayer was that a man would pray standing between two women and a woman would pray standing between two men. This was in response to some anti-Islam propaganda which claims that Islam humiliates women by lowering their status and obliging them to pray behind men, which is not true. The undeniable fact, of which I have no doubt, is that the Islamic Sunnah permits men and women to do congregational prayers in the same area, but in separate rows. Islam respects women, honors them, and acknowledges their rights, which in general terms are reasonable, given the natural and biological differences between the two sexes. And then the person who prepared this summary concludes by saying, Shaykh Abdullah Quilliam concluded by stating his opposition to the spread of alcohol in the Muslim countries and the increase in advertising it in stations, main streets and everywhere. He advised young Muslims to resist this evil and to forbid it and to work to remove it and to obey what they have been commanded in the deen and to ignore what the enemies of Islam say. This is a summary of the lecture given by Shaykh Abdullah Quilliam. It had a great impact and made love for him grow in the hearts of all his listeners, which was the best gift and greatest rewards which he could receive for all his hard work in struggling to exalt the words of Allah and his deen, Islam. The influential people in his life, certainly Sultan Abdulhamid II was one of the most influential people in his life. He recognized him long before anyone else did, and he honored him, and this then had repercussions. Now, Sultan Abdulhamid II was born in 1819. Shaykh Abdullah Quilliam was born in 1856. So, you know, there's a good 30 years difference between them. 1885, Gordon of Khartoum is killed in the Battle of Omdurman. 1887 is when Shaykh Abdullah Quilliam embraces Islam in Morocco. 1893 is when Shaykh Abdullah Quilliam was appointed as the Sheikh of Islam of the British Isles. So it's right in the middle of this whole colonial, European colonial thrust in the Muslim lands. And the offensive against the Ottoman Empire. 1898, Kitchener wins the Battle of Omdurman. He's sent in ready to avenge the death of Gordon and to re-establish British dominance of the Sudan. And it's interesting because also this is the year that the mayor of Liverpool is invited and accepts the invitation and attends the Eid celebrations at the Centre of Brown Centre in Liverpool. So this kind of highlights one of the contradictions almost that Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam found himself in. In an interview he said, I'm British by birth and I'm a Muslim by conviction. Professor Rongeith Jeeves has highlighted that comparison that was made about Roman Catholic Christians in England having allegiance, obviously, to the Queen and to the state, but also acknowledging the authority of the Pope in Rome. This was the same parallel. And as the Prophet Muhammad said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the shahada is easy on the tongue, but a lot hangs on it. And this was something that Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam soon discovered. He became Muslim because at last he came across a clear exposition of Tawheed that didn't require mental gymnastics and doublethink, as Ullah termed it, to try and get his head around the doctrine of the Trinity. He said, you know, if you want to understand life, you won't understand it through the doctrine of the Trinity. He said, if Jesus is a human, then he has human limitations. If Jesus is God, then he has no limitations at all. You can't have both together. It just doesn't work. And this was his sort of forthright way of approaching these matters. I mean, books have been written on the subject. And again, you know, one could spend the whole afternoon just talking about this, but I'll avoid it. But he was very forthright, and you could see that he was so refreshed by having access to a teaching that for the most part had not reached the people of England in any shape or form, and which gave him access to an understanding of existence which was unfettered by concepts which just didn't match up with life as each one of us basically experiences it. And this was what he called people to initially, just as the Prophet did. When he first started making da'wah in Mecca, he called people to Allah. He didn't call people to the Sharia. It was still, most of it had yet to be actually revealed. This was the Medinan period, when the hudud of Allah were made clear. But the Prophet ﷺ was given the prayer in the Laylat al-Isra wal-Mi'raj in the Meccan period. And so he then called people to do the prayer, to worship God. At the Kaaba, you know, this was the beginning, if you like, of the removal of the idols with which the Kaaba had been filled. And in the same way, he concerned himself with removing the idols that people had in their hearts, because worship of other than Allah is from the heart, just as sincere worship of Allah is from the heart. And as Allah says, two hearts do not beat in the breast of man. So what your heart is filled with is very important. And the more it's filled with light, and the less it's filled with rubbish, the better off you are. And this was what he was concerned with. But this manifested then in social action. He looked after the poor. You know, lords like Lord Stanley, you know, they would say the shahada with him. But at the same time, as Professor Rongeith has illustrated, if a sailor died and he was owed money, he'd make darn sure that so his family received it, and also that he received a burial, a Muslim burial. So he was concerned with social responsibility at a time when there were no really social welfare services for what would then be termed legally as other religions. You know, Islam wasn't even mentioned by name in the law of England at that time. Judaism was just about being recognized. But certainly in the laws of those times, there would be a mention of Christianity, there would be a mention of Judaism, and then other religions. So in terms of the people who followed that religion, there were very few very little provision made in terms of legal rights or social welfare. And this was something that he took on. And as the Prophet Muhammad said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the servant is the master. And he was a servant for his community. He didn't go around saying, I'm the Sheikh of Islam. Listen to me. Take orders and obey. He served people. And he benefited people as much as he could. And this is the mark, not only of a great man, but also of a wise man. I think it was T.S. Eliot who said, the only wisdom we can hope to acquire is the wisdom of humility. Humility is endless. And this is always the characteristic of a wise person, that they have humility. And he certainly possessed it. Now, we've heard how there was this incredible surge, really, of Dawah, you know, people coming to the deen in significant numbers. You know, there came a time when people stopped throwing stones, basically, because he was recognized not only by Sultan Abdul Hamid II, but also by the Shah of Persia, you know, by the ruler of the Maghrib, who appointed him as an honorary alim. His status was recognized by Queen Victoria. He gave her a copy of his book, his Introduction to Islam, and having read it, she then ordered 6 more copies for her children. So once he had status, then he was in a position, for example, to stop the plague on the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He became hard, and yet he lived at a time where he was on a cusp. I don't know if he knew it at the time, but certainly if you looked at it in terms of the yin-yang symbols, when he was starting, he was like the white dot in the black half of the yin-yang. And Ataturk was like the black dot in the white half, you know, in the Ottoman Empire. And there's this wonderful story of Sultan Abdul Hamid II suddenly deciding one day to go and honour the cadets in his military academy. And, you know, they would all be given honours, you know, every year. It was part of the kind of function, if you like, of how the Ottoman Caliphate operated. The future leaders and the future generals of the army would be decorated when they completed their initial training. And he went and he was pinning on, you know, the medal on each cadet, you know, who qualified as an officer. And suddenly he came to the young Ataturk. And he took a step back and he said, ah, so you've come. He knew immediately who he was. He knew who he was. But he still gave him the badge, and then he carried on. And it's often said to him, you know, why didn't you stop a young Turk movement? These Freemasonically backed people who were up to depose you, why didn't you stop them? He said, once I saw a group of them crossing the Bosphorus and landing at the landing stage, and then I saw Al-Khidr on a white horse in the background, and I said to myself, Kismet, you know, this is the decree of Allah, I can't stop. And it's therefore interesting that you think, you see, when you read the story, why was Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam suddenly summoned to Constantinople, to Istanbul, in 1908. What was it that made Sultan Abdul Hamid II call him to come? He'd been a regular visitor to visit with Sultan Abdul Hamid II. But this somehow was a different summons, and it was almost secretive, and no reason was given. And as we know, he didn't return. He said, you know, when he was going, he said, I'll be back in 6 months, as usual. But he didn't return for quite a while. But this, in fact, was the year before Sultan Abdul Hamid II was deposed as the Sultan. And really, he was the last of the great caliphs of Islam, you could say. And so, inshallah, in the future, the caliphate is restored, as the Prophet Muhammad promised. And there's nothing that the present Prime Minister can do about that. You know, it's always a criminal offence to mention the caliphate in this day and age, but you can can be assured it will be restored in due course, as a mercy as well, because the Prophet Muhammad said, this matter becomes as a prophecy in the mercy, meaning himself, then it will become a khalifah in the mercy, meaning the khalifah Rashidun, then it will become a khalifah in the tyranny, and you will see all sorts of terrible things, which anyone who studies history will see examples of that. And he said then towards the end of time, it will return again as a khalifah in the mercy. So we have this promise from the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's good news for the Mu'minun and bad news for Kafirun, that's right. And then what happened? Because we don't have news of Shaykh Abdullah Quilliam returning until 1914. And this is a phenomenal year. It's the beginning of the First World War. It's the year of the Balfour Declaration. It's the time of the Russian Revolution. Things were being changed, turned upside down. And under cover of the First World War, Palestine was occupied by the British, and the Turkish were fought and defeated. And by 1924, the Khalifate had been officially abolished. And so, just in 1918, for example, 1917, we have Major Allenby entering Jerusalem, and 1918 taking Damascus, Homs, and Aleppo. It's interesting because one of my grandfathers, on my father's side, was a scholar in Hebrew, Greek, Latin, Arabic. I wish I had met him. He died before I met him, but I wish I had. I sometimes wonder, did Abdullah Quilliam meet him? Because their paths must have crossed at some point or other. He was a priest. He was a professor of dogmatic theology at the university, so he didn't have the good fortune to accept Islam, as far as I know. But I think they must have had something in common. Certainly, my grandfather was with Major Allenby during the occupation of Palestine because he linguistically knew the territory, he acted as an interpreter. And I wouldn't be surprised if he'd acted also for British intelligence. So this is an aspect that I found interesting because he also was a Freemason, he was a Master Mason, so was Abdullah Quilliam. And it's very interesting, you see, that as far as Freemasonry is concerned, there's an aspect which is to do with business connection. But when it comes on to foreign policy, when it comes on to providing munitions, when it comes to underwriting the costs of war, then it takes on another element. And certainly, I've met PhD students, you know, whose study, whose PhD has been on the Freemasonic involvement in the Darfur of Khalifah. And I wonder, you know, maybe this is something that can be researched. It's not something, it's just an idea that's come to me, but this would be an interesting aspect to research. How did Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam deal with his being a Freemason and then with the activities of the Freemasons to actually downfall the person who had appointed him as the Sheikh of Islam? Because from what I can see, Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam was very loyal to Sultan Abd al-Mahdi II. He spoke out for him. He criticized the foreign policy that was bringing about his downfall. And the downfall of the Caliph. He spoke out against the occupation of the Muslim lands and the slaughter that took place, especially once the British army had the Maxim machine gun. But he spoke out about the slaughter of the Muslims in the Second Battle of Omdurman, where basically Kitchener had machine guns against spears and swords, and obviously, you know, just murdered people down. And it's an interesting situation. In a way, I wouldn't have liked to have been in his shoe. But you can see why, when he came back in 1914 to England, for him the world had changed dramatically. The person who had appointed him as Sheikh al-Islam was no longer the Sultan. He'd been replaced by a puppet. It was only a matter of years before even the puppets were removed. And therefore, he no longer had that status that he had enjoyed when he left in 1908. And I have a feeling that probably Sultan Abd al-Mahdi II had summoned him to say, look, this is the way the wind is blowing, and this is what you should do now. And I wouldn't be surprised also that in this time he went on the Hajj. I don't know, because I haven't come across, I tried to find on the internet evidence of him having gone on the Hajj, and I couldn't find any mention of it, and I can't believe that he didn't go on the Hajj. But again, this would be a very interesting area of research to actually look at his Hajj and whether he wrote any account of it. I understand all his papers, he might have written about it, but all his papers were burnt after his death, including the cottage that they were housed in. And maybe we've lost that account for good, but it would be interesting to try and discover it if it's there somewhere in some attic. But certainly when he came back, you can understand why he didn't return to Liverpool. Suddenly things had changed dramatically. Suddenly he was in his lifetime accused of being a traitor, of committing treason, because he acknowledged his allegiance to the Empress Victoria, but he also acknowledged his allegiance to Sultan Abdul Hamid II, and it wasn't just religious, there was a political aspect to it. You can see from the fatwas that Professor Ranjit quoted in his book that he took seriously the responsibility of actually guiding people on how they should act in a certain political situation context. So, for example, he said, don't join the army and go and kill Muslims. And don't even support the people who are doing it. And you find the same thing happening today. I give the same advice to Muslims. I said, don't allow yourself to be sent to Afghanistan to kill Muslims, because you're going to have to answer to a lot of it. You may have to answer to the British government here. You may be called martial, but if I was you, I wouldn't go and kill one single Muslim, even if they're fighting in self-defense of their country, let alone if they're innocent non-combatants. And we see today that the policy of the Americans, it is not even to identify the people they're killing. They just send in the drone and wipe out the whole village, men, women, and children. And then they say, oh, suspected insurgents were killed in such and such a place. They don't know, they don't realize that Allah sees and knows everything. The recording angels are recording everything. They will have to answer for these actions. For people like Bush, for people like Blair, for people like Obama, if they don't accept Islam, they've endorsed the death of one innocent person. The consequences in the next world are very grave. And Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam was aware of this, and he spoke out about it. He couldn't stop it. But as Professor Ranjit has illustrated, he wasn't afraid to speak the truth publicly and to call people to account, because this is part of the true principles of democracy. I mean, today's modern democracy is a far cry from the model that it's said to be modeled on, the Greek model. But nevertheless, the most noblest principle is not just to identify people so that they can be made to pay taxes to service the national debt. That's not democracy, but that's how it functions today, in fact, if you dig a little bit beneath the surface. And he really caught the best. And then, just looking a bit more on the timeline very quickly, I realise that time is passing. But 1918 was when Sultan Abdul Hamid II died. If you get a chance, visit his grave, buried with his family in Istanbul. There's such a Jalal presence. It reminded me of the grave of the companion of the Prophet who's buried in Kaiwan, who used to cut the Prophet's hair. I forget his name. But again, it was just incredible. When I went to visit him to make dua for him, there was such a fierce light there. You know, his presence, his spiritual presence was very fierce. And it's the same as Sultan Abdul Hamid II. So he died in 1918. 1923, we get the treaties of Lausanne. This is when the lands of the Caliphate are being carved out. And interestingly enough, in the records of these treaties of Lausanne are the records of how many Muslims were slaughtered by the Russian and French troops, especially. And it's interesting that they've tried to turn it back to France and say it's the Armenians who were getting slaughtered. In fact, when you look at the records, you find 6 million Muslims killed. And there's a very interesting exposition of that by Sheikh Dr. Abdullah Quilliam, which you can find on YouTube. 1924, Caliphate was abolished. 1932, Sheikh Abdullah Quilliam died. So, in his life, he saw the Caliphate functioning and he saw it gone. No wonder when he came back, he had to have a low profile. And I think that the reason given in the introduction here that he partly changed his name in order to facilitate his wife Miriam's inheriting from his friend Marcel de Lyon. Also, there's more to it than that. If you put yourself in his shoes, he would realize that, as Tony Blair once said, you know, the rules of the game have changed. They're always changing.